Hello and welcome to my tutorial for APL Voro, where I am going to walk you through all its functions and how to use them. The installation process or the used algorithms won't be discussed here, so please refer to the documentation at aplvoro.com/documentation. Should you have any issues with the software or want to propose improvements, please post an issue at the APL Voro Bitbucket repository. Without further ado, let's get started. When you start APL Voro, you will see this rather plain window. The area on the left is where open simulations are listed. The big area on the right is where various docs can be placed and organized. At the bottom is the simulation control. We start by loading a new simulation. Click on File, New, or press Ctrl N. This will open the setup wizard that will guide you through the process. On the first page, you select which simulation is loaded and which algorithms are applied for the analysis. The first field is the name by which the simulation will be referred to in APL Voro. The name doesn't have to be unique, but it is recommended. In my example, I have a simulation for the interaction of a Pseudomonas aeruginosa membrane and polymyxine B. This next section is there to define the box dimensions used for the structure file. The structure file usually contains this information, and to use it, we need to check the box here. But in case it's missing, it can be defined here manually. This option has, however, no effect on the trajectory frames. In the options section, we define which algorithms are used and how they behave. The first option is for defining how much of the membrane is duplicated over the periodic boundary condition before the Voronoi tessellation is calculated. 20% is usually a good value to use, but in my case, I'm increasing it to 30%. APL Voro will perform a surface fit for the membrane that is used for one leaflet detection algorithm. The result is a two-dimensional polynomial. This option defines the degree of this polynomial. A high degree leads to a better fit, but the current implementation becomes unstable for high degrees, so I recommend a maximum degree of 7, but I will leave the value as it is. The next two options define the algorithms used for membrane thickness calculation and leaflet detection. For my simulation, I choose the position-based leaflet detection and leave the thickness algorithm as is. Finding the best options for your project is unfortunately a matter of trial and error. In the next section, we select which frames to load. It is mostly self-explanatory. If you want to load frames until the end of the trajectory file, set last frame to -1. I will use 2000 frames for the demonstration. Down here, we select the simulation files. Model file in the PDB format is mandatory. An index file can be added to define non-lipid molecules on a membrane, like proteins, or in my case, polymyxine B. Finally, we can add a trajectory file in either TRR or XTC format. After all that, we can go to the next page of the setup wizard. This page will only appear when we define an index file on the previous page. Otherwise, it will be skipped. Here, we select which atoms will be inserted into the membrane as non-lipid atoms. I will check the box for polymyxine B. At the top, we have an option for the TPIM offset method. TPIM stands for Triangular Prism Insertion Method. This option changes the maximum distance a non-lipid atom can have to the membrane while still being inserted. The default option is to use the van der Waals radii for this distance, but it can also be user-defined. The absolute option sets the distance to zero. I will use the van der Waals radii. This is the final page of the setup wizard, where we select the key atoms used for the analysis. We see a list of molecules in the simulation. To select the key atoms, open the atom list for a lipid and then check the box for the desired key atoms. Selecting multiple key atoms per molecule means that the average position of these atoms will be used for the analysis. The selected key atoms will be displayed next to each molecule. A common practice is to use the phosphorus atom in each lipid as key atom. The auto-select button uses this information and will automatically select the first phosphorus for each molecule. When all key atoms are selected, click on Finish. The simulation will now be loaded. This can take some time. Once loading is done, we get a new entry in the list of open simulations on the left. I already loaded a second one. Each entry contains the name, three buttons to open views in the docking area, and two fields with the first and last frame used to synchronize different simulations. More on that later. Let's start by opening a Voronoi view by clicking on this button. Now, let me zoom in a bit. Here, the membrane is visualized as a Voronoi diagram, where each lipid is represented by a cell. The navigation is simple. You use the scroll wheel for zooming and hold the middle mouse button to move the diagram around. The Voronoi view serves several purposes. One is obviously visualization, but it also offers various metrics for the membrane and lipids, like area or thickness. Finally, you can create selections of lipids that can then be investigated further. Selections can be made directly on the Voronoi diagram by simply clicking a cell or using box selection. Holding the control button will add to the current selection. Another way is to use the hierarchical list of lipids on the left. Expanding the lipids entry gives a list of lipid types. Clicking one of these checkboxes selects all lipids of that type. Expanding one of these shows the list of lipids of the type along with detailed information. Again, you can make selections from this list. The third option is to create a selection model by clicking this button. Here, you can select lipids based on type or residue, area, thickness, and the number of neighbors. The current selection can be utilized as well. First, define a name for your selection model. I'll go with a model that selects lipids of the type LP0 with a small area. This requires a model that matches two criteria, so I set this option to selection will match all criteria. The first criterion shall match the lipid type. Then I add another criterion and set it to is not area greater than 1.5. When I click OK, the selection model will be accessible in this drop-down menu. Now let's get to the configuration of the Voronoi view. Right-clicking anywhere in this area opens a context menu. We'll first have a look at the settings. Here you can adjust the color scheme of the rendering area, for example background color or line color. The color scale used for the visualization can be changed here, and the grid spacing is changed here. The last section is titled Coloring Margins. This defines the minimum and maximum value used to map the color scale. This can be adjusted for lipid area and membrane thickness separately. Global margins means that the margins are chosen as the minimum and maximum value occurring across all loaded simulations. Local margins take the minimum and maximum from only the simulation belonging to this Voronoi view. With custom margins, you can define the color margins yourself. The next entry in the context menu lets you change the depicted membrane leaflet. After that, we can choose the metric that is visualized. By default, that is the area per lipid, but let's change that to thickness. With the next two entries, you can toggle the grid and the legend on and off. Then you have the option to export the Voronoi view as an image. What you see is what you get. The last option will center the Voronoi diagram in the view, useful should the diagram go out of bounds like this. And finally, you can export a simulation or parts of it as a text file that can then be used for further analysis using other applications or scripts. First, select which frames to export. Using this checkbox will only export the current frame. Otherwise, the export will include all frames from this one to this one. You may then want to limit the export to a specific selection. That can be done here. And as you see, the selection model that I defined earlier disappears here. Next, I will show you how to create 2D graphs. Clicking this button opens a view for graph drawing. To add a new graph, click on the plus button. Here you can now select what to plot. First, choose from which simulation the data is taken. Then select the leaflet and whether you want to plot average area, average thickness, or the total area. Under data, you can choose the selection model defined in the Voronoi view. This will only plot the data fitting the model. The color used for this graph is changed here. Finally, give the graph a name and click Save. Let me do that again to add another graph, this time for the control simulation. The graphs added will appear in this list on the left. Double-clicking an entry lets you change the color. This checkbox controls whether or not a graph is visible. To delete a graph, select it and click the minus button. Now to the toolbar on the top. With zoom, you can perform a box zoom. To reset the zoom, click here. Here, you can adjust the colors for the background, marker, and grid in the plotting area. This button toggles the marker on and off. The marker indicates at which point the simulation currently is. This will be useful when using a 2D plot in conjunction with Voronoi views. And of course, you can export the data of a graph as an XVG file or turn the plot into an image. The third view offered by APL Voro is the averages view. This offers you a quick overview on the average area, average thickness, and total area for each lipid on each leaflet, averaged over all loaded frames. Now that I have shown you all views, let's see how they work together. I already have the two graphs for the average area per lipid on the upper leaflet. The area per lipid in the control membrane is very stable, while the membrane treated with polymyxin B has a more erratic and decreasing area per lipid starting at around 350 frames. Now I open the Voronoi view for both simulations to investigate what's going on. The views will always appear at the very right and can be arranged via drag and drop in the docking area. Alternatively, you can drag views out of the docking area and, for example, place them on a second screen. Right now, we see frame 0 of the simulations. Using the simulation control at the bottom, we can change the displayed frame. You can play the simulation very slowly by default, and adjust the playback speed using this slider. Alternatively, you can drag the frame slider around or type in a specific frame number. Let's see what happens at this point of interest at around 350 frames. Okay, we see that white cells start to appear in the treated membrane. That is the polymyxin B entering the membrane, where it displaces the lipids and shoves them closer together, resulting in a decreasing area per lipid. We now come to the last part of the tutorial. As you can see, I have loaded a third simulation. This simulation is for Pseudomonas aeruginosa that survived treatment with polymyxin B and has adapted its membrane composition. When adding a graph for the average area per lipid, we see that it is significantly smaller than the other membrane. But we also see that the moment the polymyxin B has the first contact with the membrane is slightly earlier, at around 230 frames. I now want to show you how to synchronize the simulations on this event of polymyxin B hitting the membrane. That's what these fields are for. The upper field defines the first frame for synchronization, and the lower field the last frame for synchronization. In the first simulation, the polymyxin B hits on frame 343. And in the other simulation, on frame 225. I set the last frame to 1843 and 1725 respectively, which gives us 1500 frames to compare our membranes. With this, we synchronized the two simulations, and now we can view them side by side using the Voronoi views. This concludes the tutorial. Thank you for watching.